The ruling classes in the South turned their backs on the more painful aspects of their history. Just as history had turned its back on them some 150 years before, when Abraham Lincoln campaigned for the freedom of the slaves in the Civil War. In this extremely commercial region of North America, with its huge cotton plantations all along the Mississippi River, the defeat of the southern states was particularly damaging. Dreams of domination persisted, even when the disappearance of cheap black labor had long since destroyed any basis for such dreams. Behind the social veneer, which was intended to hide the actual wretchedness of the oppressed classes which still existed, the self-esteem of the ruling class was gradually breaking down. Tennessee Williams, a Southerner by birth and by conviction, was well aware of what was happening in the Mississippi Delta, and he reflected it in his play, Cat on a Hot Tin Roof. The setting was the plantation of Big Daddy Paulet, who, through hard work, had become a multimillionaire.
This is a beautiful afternoon.
Nice and cool for this time of the year.
Yeah, and it's good to be back on this old plantation.
Good to have you back, Big Daddy.
Ah, here comes the coffee now. We can start and celebrate Big Daddy's birthday. And his test results...
On the occasion of his 65th birthday, there was a family gathering. Big Mama, Daddy's favorite son, Brick, and his wife, Maggie, the cat, as well as his eldest son, together with his insufferable family.
Here's to you.
Where has Brick got to, anyway?
After the suicide of his friend Skipper, Brick had turned away from Maggie and become a drinker.
Brick, I hardly think it's time for something like that, do you?
He couldn't drive out the memory of his beloved friend. And from the moment when Maggie had hinted at homosexual tendencies, Brick had no longer gone near her.
Maggie? Brick? Something wrong between you two?
A drink? I drink when I damn well please.
What's that?
But Maggie, the cat, had refused to give up. She continued to fight.
Except your son's been drinking again.
What's wrong with you, boy?
The father became involved in one of their fights. He wanted to know why his son needed to drink.
Big Daddy. Listen, you kids just go on out of here. Not now. Get out of here. Maggie, would you leave us? I want to talk to Brick. Just leave us for a minute. What's wrong with you, boy? Why do you drink?
He tried to free Brick from the vicious circle of alcohol and self-deception.
What do you have to
He himself was very ill. And he refused to accept Brick's answer that he was drinking in order to forget, since he knew it would not be long before Brick could expect to inherit the Paulet plantation and the job of running it. The conflict came to a head in a quarrel over the inheritance. Big Mama got very little support from her daughter-in-law, May, who manipulated her two children, little monsters drilled in pleasantries, against Maggie.
Because, sister woman, you don't have children. You have little...
All the members of the family lied to one another. Hypocrisy and a false sense of morality ruled. The father had been aware of it for a long time. The model for the character of Big Daddy, with all the positive sides to his personality, is Williams' own father, Cornelius Coffin Williams. He came from an old pioneer family, and whilst working as a commercial representative, he married the beautiful puritanical woman, Edwina Dakin. A son was born on the 26th of March, 1911, in Columbus, Mississippi. He was Thomas Lanier Williams III, who would later take the name of Tennessee to emphasize the fact that he was from the South. Tennessee's family was burdened with looking after a daughter, Rose, who was very pretty, but who was born mentally retarded. It was because of this that their son Tom was given over into the care of his grandparents. His grandmother came from a German immigrant family. Her husband was a well-educated, well-read, and very liberal clergyman in the Presbyterian Church. Tennessee found refuge from the fierce quarreling between his tyrannical father and his God-fearing mother in his grandfather's library. And this was where he discovered his first literary models. He read Chekhov at the age of 14 and D.H. Lawrence shortly after. And he soon began to write himself. When he was 17, he earned $25 for his first published short story. Tennessee Williams fled from the provincial confines of his family as soon as he could, and finally ended up in New Orleans. The so-called Pearl of the South, once its capital, was for him, as it was for so many others, the liveliest and most liberal-minded city in America.
That bill only 211 years old, and would you believe it or not, you still get drunk in that. Ed is over to my left there. John the Sea Blackman, my daddy is there. And also over to my left, the old coffee pot there. Get some good breakfast, good gumbo there.
Not only in the French Quarter, but in the whole of the rest of the city, stretching from the harbor to the Garden District, which one could easily cover in a hackney cab, Tennessee experienced a certain atmosphere which he would evoke again and again in his plays. In 1938, when he was 27 years old, he finally decided to settle in New Orleans. He rented a room at number 722 Toulouse Street. In this house, he set about working towards his future fame. The city for him was an inexhaustible source of exciting contacts, images, and experiences. He loved this hot, wild New Orleans, which was astonishing, given his nervous, unstable temperament. New Orleans was the El Dorado for idlers, a gathering point for the happy-go-lucky. Here, everybody treated everybody else with tolerance. In this environment, Tennessee Williams discovered his love for both men and alcohol. And it was also the place where he began to work with a frenzy. It was very much the same then as it is now. On every corner, there's a band playing the indefatigable New Orleans jazz. And the musicians, just as indefatigable, waiting for clinking coins. Little tap dancers are not far behind the bands, and they are also familiar with the generosity of the tourists. Peace reigns just a little further on in the center of the old city of New Orleans. It wasn't just the French who built it. Spanish domination lasted 37 years and has also left its mark, such as here in Cabildo Street. At the end of the 18th century, this was the office of the Spanish governor. Bohemians found their niche in the alleyways and the courtyards. And in the main, they were young artists and writers and their followers. But the iron fences and gateways in the old town of New Orleans did not imply any restrictions to personal freedom. Quite the contrary. They provided protection for a life in the back courtyards of the French Quarter, which often indulged in excesses. Tennessee, represented here by someone who looks very like him, was by then a poet and a stage writer, and no longer a complete unknown, although one couldn't say he was yet a huge success. And his lifestyle was also very different at the time. He had to work very hard so that he could drink his favorite Napoleon whiskey or go to one of the many atmospheric bars. For Tennessee, New Orleans was a constant temptation without mercy. When he was broke, and that was almost always, Tennessee would work as a waiter, serving the whiskey, which he'd have been only too willing to drink, as a customer. He turned heavily to alcohol for solace when his first stage play, Battle of Angels, failed at its premiere in Boston in 1940. He was deeply disappointed by his failure, but he kept on writing, and although melancholy, he was not dismayed. His swings of mood found their expression in his stage plays and in music, which very soon became an integral part of his drama. And there was nowhere where he found it easier to write than New Orleans, which was a magnet for vagrants and exiles. This city in which he felt so at home was a kindred spirit. For his next play, The Glass Menagerie, Williams found the theme and the characters within his own family. It is the story of a poor bourgeois widow, Amanda Winfield, who dreams of a good match for her daughter, Laura. Her son, Tom, is supposed to help and to act as a go-between between his sister and one of his work colleagues, Jim. The space on the stage corresponds to the confines in which the play takes place.
Hey, Laura, I've got something for you. Standalone wine. It's good.
Jim, who is already being regarded as a future son-in-law by Laura's mother, Amanda, attempts to have a conversation with Laura, who is extremely shy and unworldly.
Laura, so what have you been doing all these years?
Laura's mother and brother do not let the pair out of their sight. Jim asked Laura how she spends her time.
I took a business class.
Laura, who was modeled exactly on William's sister Rose, replies that she used to go to business school, but had to give it up.
Because the class gave me indigestion.
Indigestion?
But Jim doesn't give up, but goes on asking questions, and Laura then tells him all about her dream world in a naive, childlike, and almost touching way.
So what else have you been doing?
Oh, don't think I've been sitting around doing nothing. I have my glass menagerie. It takes up a lot of my time. I have to polish it and clean it.
A glass?
Glass menagerie. Glass is something you have to be very careful with.
Laura, can I sit next to you?
Jim believes that Laura suffers from strong feelings of inferiority.
You know what I expect to be the problem? Inferiority complex. Do you know what that is?
He is a very normal young man and instinctively detects that Laura is on the way to becoming part of her own glass menagerie.
Look at your hair.
Watched by her brother Tom, Jim then attempts to explain to Laura, who listens with fascination, that there is something outside her dream world, namely life, the fast life in New Orleans, and love from other people. It looks as though her mother Amanda's wishes are about to come true.
Just need somebody to kiss you. Oh my God. I'm a stumble, John.
But Laura's reaction is one of being both petrified and bewildered and delighted all at the same time. She has never experienced anything like it before, and she has trouble coping with her impressions and feelings. For Amanda, who is very like Tennessee Williams' own mother, what happens next is a sheer catastrophe.
I'm engaged.
Then you're not coming back?
I can't come back, Laura.
Jim tells Laura that he is engaged, and he quickly leaves the Winfield household. It is certain that Laura will now withdraw completely into her dream world.
Oh, Laura. No. Honey, I'm so sorry.
Tennessee Williams reflected the battles and disappointments in his own life in his plays. He restlessly roamed the streets and bars of New Orleans, always on the lookout for impressions which he could then record in his literary works. To the rhythms of New Orleans jazz, which rang out through the whole city, Williams, who was rather shy, drank to get the courage he needed to pick up bedfellows off the street. He usually returned home in the early hours, would write for a couple of hours, sleep a little, but by 11 o'clock, he would already be drinking whiskey again in the courtyards of the old city. He hated his homosexuality, which brought him constantly into conflict with the strict puritanical upbringing of his childhood. For his whole life, he longed for a stable, long-lasting relationship. But in New Orleans, he was not to find it. This harbor city, frequented by artists, was a place for fleeting relationships and unstable friendships. But the city had other charms to which Tennessee Williams was susceptible. And these also went into his plays. The ever-young New Orleans jazz, which one can still hear played today in Preservation Hall. New Orleans and jazz. The Crescent City Joymakers, already themselves a legend. New Orleans jazz seems to raise the expectations one has in life itself. The trombone and the banjo, a combination which has lasted for almost 200 years. Thank you. It was then that the Glass Menagerie suddenly became an overnight success. After a somewhat unsure rehearsal in Chicago, the play opened in New York, the center of culture in the United States, on the 31st of March, 1945. Williams drove to the premiere. It was a huge success. The critics were impressed and poured their praises on the writer. The highly respected New York Times judged the play to be sensitive, moving, charming, and all in all, perfect. The Rockefeller Foundation had fewer words to say. They just sent Williams a check for $1,000. For the very first time, he no longer suffered from a chronic shortage of money. The dollars, and later the royalties, were enough to retain Audrey Wood. Williams valued Audrey highly, and throughout the 30 years she worked as his agent, he remained true to her, which was very unlike him. Whenever Tennessee Williams had to live in New York, and he came mostly for business reasons, he was unaffected by the bustle and the luxury of the city. He maintained a totally separate lifestyle. Even if he came for a long stay, he found the YMCA hotel quite adequate for his needs. It was peaceful and clean. There was nothing else he wanted, just as long as he could work. He would often go jogging in Central Park, in an era long before jogging became fashionable. The huge success of The Glass Menagerie at first made its author quite euphoric. But he soon found out what the downside of success was. Williams, a Southerner, soon encountered the coldness, the hardness, and the intrigue which surrounded any success in New York. But in spite of this, he still returned again and again to New York. There were a number of reasons why. New or worked plays had to be offered to the theater. There were concepts and direction to discuss with directors and artists. And no other stage writer had such exact images of his plays on stage as Williams. His stage directions read almost like a novel attached to the play. And overseas performance rights were also handled in New York. But the triumph he enjoyed with The Glass Menagerie was not so quick to repeat itself. Williams attempted to counteract his violent mood swings, which went between euphoria and depression, with alcohol and drugs. And as was his way, he vastly overdid it. It was this which prompted a tendency in him to imagine new illnesses all the time, and this developed into an almost pathological predisposition towards hypochondria. Although, as a Southerner, he rejected the way of life in New York, he did believe that he received better medical treatment there, whenever he was suffering from some real or imagined illness. He had treatment three times in New York for the cancer, which he did not have, and for a rare second appendix. And he underwent four operations for glaucoma. He also consulted psychiatrists, psychoanalysts, and drug specialists without any real success worth mentioning. To escape New York, Williams made his way back to the South. A friend once said of him that he never traveled to get somewhere, but always traveled to get away from somewhere. He headed for Key West. The dramatist had a remarkably strange attitude towards cars. On the highway, he behaved quite differently on occasions from the way he behaved in real life. He was no stranger to the police in Florida. Once, he even landed up in jail.
Driver's license registration.
I have no license.
Father Gabriel.
Williams bought himself a house in Key West. Over the years, it became a meeting place for painters, musicians, and writers. Williams lived here for 14 years with Frank Merlo, with whom he shared a serious relationship, which for him was very much the exception. Near the house in the garden, there was a pavilion for Jane Bowles. Williams considered her to be the best writer of her day. The household swimming pool was in no way enough for Williams. He needed water to live as much as he needed air, and the beach at Key West became his favorite place to relax. Of all the many people who were put up at Key West over the years, the most welcome was his grandfather, Dakin, whom he always thought of with gratitude. Williams was always accompanied by dogs, and in Florida he was able to look after them better than anywhere else. He was also a passionate angler. He shared this passion with his famous colleague Hemingway, who had himself lived for many years in Key West. During the time when Williams was still getting to know and enjoy the peculiarities of Florida, Hemingway was already living in Cuba, but Williams did not lag far behind him with regard to the better aspects of the almost Caribbean atmosphere. There were reminders of Hemingway every step of the way in Key West. In the Cafe Exile, for instance, or at Sloppy Joe's, which was Hemingway's old local, and where, as Williams would later report, Hemingway's friends still sat up at the bar. At the house of his famous colleague, whom he held in a certain amount of awe, which had in the meantime become overrun with cats, Williams was a regular guest in spite of the absence of the master. He would often sit for hours on the veranda with Hemingway's ex-wife Pauline, and from the stories which she told him, he got to know a Hemingway who was very different from the Hemingway he himself imagined, a Hemingway who was no macho man, but a true gentleman. Marion Black Vaccaro was one of Williams' closest friends in Key West. She accompanied him on practically all his travels. He appreciated her sense of style and her manner, since for him she epitomized his image of a Southern lady. She was one of the few women who played a decisive role in the work of the dramatist. In Florida, Williams also found time for his family, for his sister Rose, who had just undergone a dangerous brain operation and was brought to Miami for a rest cure. Williams got his house ready for Rose, hoping that her condition would improve. When Tennessee Williams finally returned to New Orleans, to the source of his inspiration, he himself was to confess that he had turned into an obsessive playwright. A new drama appeared. He had intended to call it The Moth, but he later chose the title of The Poker Night. Tennessee Williams at that time was living in a house on the corner of Peter Street and Royal. A streetcar rumbled along the street outside, heading for the Desire terminus. A desire was a wish, a craving, an ambition. Williams became so fascinated by the ambiguity in the name that he changed the name of his play from The Poker Night to A Streetcar Named Desire. He could watch the streetcar and its passengers from this window. Today, the streetcar stands near the French Market and is a museum piece as well as a piece of literary history. Just as it did almost 50 years ago, a new silent streetcar glides past the Elysian Fields stop. Williams chose house number 632 as the setting for his story about Blanche DuBois. Again, it was the story of shattered dreams of domination in the southern states.
Stella? Stella?
Blanche leaves the small town of Laurel with nothing more than a suitcase and comes to visit her sister Stella in New Orleans. She had to leave Laurel when the Belle Reve plantation, which had at one time been a flourishing concern, had to be put up for auction, and she lost her job as a teacher. She called it a leave of absence.
Stella?
So she had not left Laurel from choice. Blanche had been declared persona non grata, since it was well known that the teacher was both a nymphomaniac and an alcoholic. She was also alleged to have shared her bed with a 17-year-old schoolboy. Blanche, like a sinner in the Middle Ages, had been exiled from her own hometown. Two sisters. The first sister, Stella, not married in keeping with her social status, but happy. The other sister, Blanche, intent on asserting her own higher status in other ways.
I had such a terrible tongue on that streetcar when I was coming up here. I mean, it was just awful. And it was a long trip. I mean, Mississippi.
It is a long time since they have seen each other, and there is a lot of news to exchange. So, as not to disturb Stella's husband in his weekly poker game, Stella and Blanche go out. After going to the cinema, they stroll through the French Quarter and finally end up at the Galatoire restaurant. Tennessee Williams was very familiar with it. When they come home, Stella's husband, Stanley Kowalski, a workman and the son of Polish immigrants, is still playing poker with his friends. Blanche's affected behavior is like a red rag to a bull for Kowalski. She, on the other hand, finds him quite impossible, but is also attracted to him. Blanche's behavior gets more and more on Kowalski's nerves, and he gets really furious when she won't say what has become of Stella's inheritance. Soon, quite a lot of tension is built up in the small house, and Stanley's friend Mitch becomes involved.
Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me. I was looking for the dressing room.
Oh, it's occupied, darling.
My name is Mitch.
Oh, how nice to meet you.
Hey, Mitch! Count me out of this one. I'm here to speak with Miss...
DuBois. His politeness flatters Blanche, and she thinks that he's making advances towards her.
My baby sister.
Oh.
I'm a little
Kowalski
older.
Wildly breaks into their conversation to drag Mitch back to the cards. When Stella tries to break up the poker game, she becomes the object of her husband's aggression as well.
Let's go.
Kowalski becomes violent towards his wife, and his friends have difficulty restraining him. Stella finally runs to a neighbor, and Kowalski will take his revenge on Blanche later on.
Get out of here, man. What a mess. I want to play a friendly game of cards.
On Broadway, the play was received with enthusiasm by both the audience and the critics in November 1947. People were both shocked and fascinated at the same time. A Streetcar Named Desire questioned the whole ethos of the American way of life, the whole myth of happiness. After a lot of persuasion, Tennessee Williams was able to get Elia Kazan to direct the play, and Kazan cast in the role of Kowalski a hitherto little-known actor by the name of Marlon Brando. For Brando, it was the beginning of a great international career. Alongside Brando was the victim Blanche, contemptuous and abrasive and reacting against his fury. Brando also played Kowalski when Kazan filmed the play 3 years later in Hollywood, with Vivian Leigh as Blanche. Kazan had a similar success with the film of Cat on a Hot Tin Roof 7 years later. In the role of Maggie, he cast Barbara Delgettes, Miss Ellie in Dallas. In the film version, Elizabeth Taylor and Paul Newman were outstanding in the leading roles. Anna Magnani. Tennessee Williams admired her the moment he met her for her class and found her performance in the play The Rose Tattoo entrancing. Williams received honor after honor and was twice awarded the coveted Pulitzer Prize. At the age of 67, he turned a critical eye on himself in his only appearance.
Since I'm a member of the human race, when I attack its behavior toward fellow members, I'm obviously including myself in the attack, unless I regard myself as not human but superior to humanity. I don't. In fact, I can't expose a human weakness on the stage unless I know it through having it myself. I have exposed a good many human weaknesses and brutalities, and consequently, I must have them. I don't even think that I am more conscious of mine than any of you are of yours. Guilt is universal. I mean a strong sense of guilt. If there exists any area in which a man can rise above his moral condition, imposed upon him at birth and long before birth, by the nature of his breed, then I think it is only a willingness to know it, to face its existence in him. And I think that at least below the conscious level, we all face it. Hence guilty feelings, and hence defiant aggressions, and hence the deep dark of despair that haunts our dreams, our creative work, and makes us distrust each other. Enough of these philosophical abstractions for now. To get back to writing for the theater, if there is any truth in the Aristotelian idea that violence is purged by its poetic representation on a stage, then it may be that my cycle of violent plays have had a moral justification after all. I know that I have felt it. I've always felt a release from the sense of meaninglessness and death when a work of tragic intention has seemed to me to have achieved that intention, even if only approximately, nearly. I would say that there is something much bigger in life and death than we have become aware of or adequately recorded in our living and dying. And further, to compound this shameless romanticism, I would say that our serious theater is a search for something that is not yet successful, but is still going on. C'est fini. Okay.
In February 1983, Tennessee Williams came to New York for the last time. He lay in the Hotel Elysee in a deep depression for days. Alcohol, drugs, and misuse of medicines had already left their mark. Tennessee Williams died on the night of the 24th of February, 1983. Williams had achieved a great deal, and he had suffered a great deal. But even he had been incapable of helping in any real way the lost souls with whom he had identified for the whole of his life. For him, his life had been a rather weak and hopeless affair. Tennessee Williams was buried in St. Louis, and not in the New Orleans, which he had loved like no other city. In his work, he had avoided all the sentimentality which people showed, even when they were deeply hurt, and his writing had brought a new direction to the American theater. He, who was perhaps the most uncitizen-like citizen of New Orleans, would have been worthy of a funeral such as this, still a tradition today. And as so often happens in life itself, the mourning does not last for long. Death may be the end of a life, but life itself goes on. The blues, once again, turn into Dixie. In the quarter, the strange procession goes past 1014 Dumaine Street. This is where the brass double bed stands in which Tennessee Williams actually wanted to die. This was his dearest wish. It was not to come true. Another wish did not come true either. It was his wish that he would be forever forgotten after his death.
Getting late over in the evening, I feel like blowing my horn.